Thanks everyone for coming to our Innovation Centre. We are officially 365 days old. Yes! So we like to do things differently at DBS. We like to do all the innovation first and then build a centre. I don't know why we did it in that order, but it seemed to work for us. What I'm going to talk about is a journey in my life over the last 4 years. It's been a very impactful journey on me. I've had quite a different life. This is my first and last job in a bank. I've done all sorts of things. As a young kid, at 11, I was writing commercial computer games. I retired at 16. I traveled the world. I was a ninja for a while. And then I taught Tai Chi and Kung Fu till roughly I was about 30. Designed aquariums, started writing websites, done software, worked at Microsoft, worked at Mastercard, and now I'm at DBS. So I've done lots of different things in my life. I don't have any qualifications. I think I'm technically the least qualified person in DBS, which is, and certainly the worst dressed, which is good. And so I really have no fear about taking on the new. I really don't have any fear at all. I'll go and try something and I'll know I'll work it out, and you know, it's either going to work or it isn't going to work, and I'm going to learn something from that. This is a journey about what I've done over the last 4 years. I've spent half my salary and half my weekends for 4 years building social enterprise hotels out in Sumatra. But the important thing really is, you know, you couldn't think of more different things. Living in Singapore and heading up innovation for one of the world's most innovative banks and building a small boutique hotel in the middle of the Sumatran jungle. But the important thing I find in life is you can learn from anything. Even though you may think they're very different things, there's actually a lot of learnings from one field you can take into the next. I call it same shape, different color. So even if it looks a different color, it looks completely different. Actually, some of the mechanics underneath that are quite similar. And so my innovation work helped me to build a hotel and an ecosystem around that. And building a hotel helped with DBS's innovation strategy. And this is what this presentation's about. I'm actually writing a book about this at the moment, about halfway through. So if anyone's good at writing, please let me know. I've got about 30,000 words left. It's my next challenge on my weekends. Let me talk through how this played out. This is me when I was working at Mastercard. I used to be head of innovation at Asia, Middle East, and Africa. Back then, I had much, much better dress sense, as you can agree. I often got mistaken for an Australian banana plantation owner quite a lot. What it did do, I used to wear them deliberately, because when I started off presenting a lot, then people would spot me afterwards at the conference, because a little bit hard to miss. Until I did a conference with a completely white background and all you could see was my head. It was quite disturbing. When I was at Mastercard, I was trying to invent a universal problem solver. So essentially a kind of program where you could put in big problems at one end and you get highly refined and successful solutions at the other. It was a combination of design thinking, lean startup, experimentation, rapid prototyping. And I wanted to test it on something that wasn't about payments or about technology. I'm a firm believer that technology has nothing to do with innovation. Sorry for all those people who kind of read all this guff coming out of Silicon Valley. You know, innovation for me is about finding a really interesting problem. That's the single most important thing. And then having a process to create a creative, elegant and successful solution. That's all innovation is in my mind. My favorite innovator is Moser, Joseph Moser, and he invented the Moser light, which was lucky because it was named after him. And basically all that is, it's very simple. It's changed tens of millions of people's lives around the world. And this is a Moser light. And so what happens, you get a bottle of water, you put a bit of bleach in it so the sun doesn't turn it green, you cut a hole in your tin roof, and you pull it in. What that enables, though, when it's raining, kids can sit inside and study because it turns into a 40-watt light bulb. Mothers can run small businesses and still work inside when there's a power blackout, they still have a level of light as long as it's light outside. That has nothing, that is not an app. It's changed tens of millions of people around the world, in South America and across Asia. So that's my favorite innovation at the moment. Where was I? MasterCard, that's right. And so the problem I thought, right, let's go for a big problem to test this new innovation technique. So the problem I went after was the orangutans. When I was a young kid, I grew up very poor. I just had a mother when I was a young kid. And I didn't have enough money for a full set of encyclopedias. I had a second-hand, like, encyclopedia in one. And we got it at a second-hand shop, and the covers were ripped. But my favorite animal in there was the orangutan. I thought that's incredibly interesting. In Sumatra, there's only about 6,000 orangutans left. In Borneo, there's about 60,000. And they were the closest living relative to humans until recently. Does anyone know what displaced them? Anyone? No, Donald Trump. He's now the closest living relative to human. I thought you'd like that. But there's only two, for those who don't know, there's not many great apes in the world. There's only two great apes that live outside Africa. There's the orangutan. Does anyone know what the other one is? Donald Trump. Humans. Only two great apes live outside Africa. Orangutans and humans, that's it. Yep. So we are all family. But the trouble is, I'm sure many of you live in Singapore, we dread the haze every year, don't we? We get the haze, what about September time? It's where they burn the jungles just before rainy season. But trouble is, sometimes the rainy season comes really late or it's really light. So the rain doesn't pull out the forest fires, and we end up in Singapore with a smoke so thick you can't even see like 50 meters. And then the PSI goes up to 300 or so, and then we don't come into work. But essentially, every time you see the haze, I want you to remember this picture, because this is what's happening. We are barbecuing the wildlife in Southeast Asia. That is the haze. Let's be very clear about that. We're barbecuing elephants, we're barbecuing tigers, we're barbecuing rhinos, gibbons, orangutan, it's all being barbecued. So we can have cheap palm oil and cheap products. Yeah, that's what the haze is about. So we need to solve that. What I did, I picked up my MasterCard Labs team, we flew into the Sumatran jungle. There they are. One of them brought their young daughter. There. I'm not sure MasterCard Insurance covered that, but we didn't tell HR, in fairness. And because it's a technique about, as I said, innovations about finding the right problem and understanding it, we spent a lot of time with the orangutans. We spent a lot of time talking to our trek guide, the villagers, the porters, the drivers. There's lots of little guest houses there. We talked to those people, and we talked to tourists. And as we went through this process, we realized that there's a few big problems there. So always start with the problems in innovation. Number one, it's full of European backpackers. Now, not only do they smell, they don't spend much money. So they're spending $5 to $10 a day, which isn't really, even in Indonesia, that's not going to drive a big change around ecotourism revenue. Secondly, the European backpackers have no local power. And so they may get engaged and understand the ecosystem, but all they do is go home and click likes on Facebook. Nothing changes. The next thing is that there's not good enough quality accommodation there. And so if you're wealthy or you want to bring your family, there's nowhere for you to stay. And so the solution was to build a small boutique, high-quality hotel out there that we could get wealthy local executives who have power, our CEOs of companies, our executives at banks who work at Google or work at Facebook, and can possibly make some change. And so that was the exercise. We ran that for about 4 days. The innovation process worked very well. About a week later, I got a phone call from our track guide, Abdullah. He said, oh, Abang means brother. He said, brother, when are you coming to help? And I said, well, it was a training exercise. We were just there, as we said, we were learning this new innovation technique we designed. It was just an exercise. They said, oh, we thought you were going to help. I said, well, I'm sorry, but I've got work to do and I've got a job, and I felt really bad about it. And then it sat at the back of my mind for about 2 weeks. And then, as cliche as it sounds really, I thought, well, if not you, then who? Who else is going to help? Who else has worked out that there's a gap here where we could affect some change? Who else is going to help the villagers? Who else is going to help the orangutans in this particular way? Well, it's no one. And so, almost grudgingly, I rang up Abdullah and said, I'm coming. Let's start the project. So the thing we came up with, our exercise, let's do it. He found us the old tourist office, which was my little abode. Very damp, leaking, little bungalow. We put a bed in there so I could stay there. Very cheap, only 400 square meters of land. So that's about 10 meters wide at the front and about 40 meters. And we started to build. So using different innovation techniques and a lot of bravery and trust, we started to build a hotel that looked very much like a car park initially. So these are neighboring properties. It went up, and finally, we built three gorgeous rooms. Now, I don't know anything about building hotels or architecture or hotel operations. I don't know about a lot of things, but I really don't think that's a barrier to entry. I didn't go on a course, I didn't study, I just went on and thought, architecture, that's a bit like innovation, surely. But I do know two things about hotel construction. One, they must look good. And two, they must stand upright. So with those kind of philosophies in my head, we ended up building a beautiful property. And it's been open, 3 years now, and it's been successful. We expanded and built a property at the top. This is where I go on the weekends. There's a penthouse up there with an Xbox and a projector and a 2 kilowatt sound system, which basically the whole village can hear me when I play The Prodigy, which is great. And so I've got a place now where I can spend time and enjoy all those journeys. I mean, the journeys were intense. So I never told anyone at DBS, because I just joined DBS. I didn't want them to think I wasn't focusing. So I catch a taxi at 5 o'clock, go to the airport, catch the flight at 7, fly for an hour into Medan in Sumatra, and then the trip up to the jungles between 3 and 12 hours. Anyone who's been to an Indonesian city understands that. And it was quite something. And then I'd get there about midnight. Once it did take 12 hours, there was such a storm it washed out two of the bridges, so I had to go the long way around via the volcano. That's another story. And I'd get there about midnight. I'd wake up Saturday. I'd check in on whether we're up to the construction, make changes, start thinking about what I need to buy. Sunday, I'd get up, go back to the capital city, and just go buy stuff like toilets, tiles. If anyone wants to know where to buy toilets in Medan, let me know. Anything. I know where everything is in Medan. I can buy you anything. Furniture, beds, paint, hammocks, pictures, whatever. I know where it is. And then I'll get back to work. I'll get back to Singapore about 10:30 p.m. on Sunday, and then wake up and go to work. So I never told anyone about this, but the bank found out. And the CEO called me into his office, Piyush, and he said, what's this about you've been doing in Sumatra with a hotel? And I told him, and I expected quite a different result. What I didn't expect was, this is brilliant. I've got 50 CEOs coming for a study tour. Please, can you talk about this? And ever since then, DBS have been, well, once they found out, they've been very supportive, and hence I can talk about an event like this. Here's a video of what the property looks like today.
Holly came from Miami, FLA. Hitchhiked away across USA. Plucked her eyebrows on the way. Shaved her legs and then he was a she. She says, hey babe, take a walk on the wild side. Said, hey honey, take a walk on the wild side.
So there we go. It's quite something. There's other little guest houses around, but it's certainly the highest quality and the most expensive. But it's really not expensive. It's still cheaper than anywhere you could get in Singapore. So there's the property. Achieve that. So what? You built a hotel. Well, the things I learned through that, I took back into DBS. Now, the thing with the jungle people is, you know, their average lifespan's pretty low. So I think their average lifespan's about 50 years old. So when you talk to them, they say someone's old, they mean 60. Yeah, and they die for lots of different reasons. One is they have fat for breakfast, fat for lunch, fat for dinner. And they smoke about 5,000 dodgy cigarettes a day, as in they don't have the same manufacturing quality that they do in other countries. And there's no kind of concept of exercise or keeping healthy, but they're very, very strong. They're very lovely people, but they have a tough life out there. But the conditions are tough. It's hot, it's humid, things break easily. But what they do to survive in an environment like that, you have to simplify and strengthen. That is the important thing. So you have to focus on the key thing and make that stronger to survive. What I found is they took my corporate innovation techniques and I started using it with them, and they simplified and strengthened them. And then we took them back to DBS and baked them into programs. The first thing I learned, this is Abdullah, my cousin there. This is his orphan nephew, Errol. And this is his other nephew, Errol, as well. They had a disaster in the village that illegal loggers had been cutting down the forest, and they put all the big trunks, tree trunks, in the river. And then there was a big storm, and it created a huge dam. And basically, it was a freshwater tsunami, which killed about a quarter of the village. And so everyone there has lost family, and there's many orphans there. That was many years ago. Thankfully, that won't happen again. They've got processes in place for that. But it ruined the tourist village. So nobody came to see the orangutans, and hence there was no money. It's a pretty tough time for them out there. But the thing I learned, one of the things I learned, is to have the right intent. I went there, and my mission's quite clear. I'm there to help save the Sumatran orangutans, and to give local villagers jobs and education. That is it. If you ask me every time, I'll say the same thing. My intent is very clear, it's very short, it's a good social intent. And so because of that, the mosque wanted to work with me because they knew my intent was to give jobs to local villagers and education. Orangutan organizations want to work with me because I'm there to help save the orangutans. So many people I meet, I'd say 90%, takes me 10 minutes to work out how to work with them. I talk to them and they're like, what do you do? Oh, I've got an AR blockchain VR system. What? We need to get through it. Oh, you automate documents. Okay, good. Why did I have to work that out? Why couldn't you have told me that? And so a lot of either companies or people or even countries don't articulate and telegraph their intent. It sounds really simple, it is so impactful. The first time you meet someone, what do? Bang, bang, bang. Oh, I know how to work with you, because we've got a project over here where we need some of this. Your intent doesn't have to be for social good, doesn't even have to be honest. But it has to be clear and simple so people know how to plug you in to their initiatives and ecosystems. It's a really, really simple thing. So think about how this could work in what you do today. We did this at the bank as well. We went through a journey of working with startups. DBS wasn't known particularly for being a startup bank. One of the things we did is try to turn students into startups. Joan, who worked on my team, she's gone on to bigger things. She came to me with a concept called Unicorn. I said, Joan, what is this? She goes, oh, it's to teach interns how to be innovators. I said, what's the intent here? She's like, oh, a new intern program? I'm like, well, I think it needs to be more powerful than that. What really is the intent? We went through it. I said, right, I've got it. I know what Unicorn is. So essentially, Unicorn's a program. We go around the universities. We ask the students to make a 30-second video on how they're going to reinvent the world. We had over 1,000 applications this year. We take the 1,000 down to 60. We put them through a hackathon. We have a psychologist watching them. They see how they team, how they lead, how they cope with stress. And then we take the final 30. We bring them in for a 3-month internship. We get 4 executive sponsors at the bank who give them their biggest problems at the bank. And we coach them like a startup in these teams. And they create a solution. At the end of 3 months, they pitch back to the executives. We roughly, on average now over 2 years, have a 60% hit rate from the student idea being implemented at the bank. So students with no history in finance, no history in innovation, no history in startups, are solving some of the bank's biggest problems. We then end up hiring half the interns, so it's a graduate acquisition program as well. I love it. It's the best. We won an award recently, Millennial 2020 Best Marketing Branding Award for a Millennial program, which was quite something. It's not to do with banking, it's across all industries. So I said to Joan, I said, right, I know what you're doing. You're reinventing education in Singapore. She goes, what do you mean? I said, well, education's fundamentally broken. There's a train wreck about to happen in the industry. So as the world and companies move more to be ecosystem and platform companies, at the same time we're seeing the gig economy rise, we're teaching the wrong things to kids. We should be making them entrepreneurs. The children of today will have 8 mini careers in their life. They might have 2 to 3 jobs a day. If the world's going to be like that, we should be teaching them how to sell, how to pitch, how to create prototypes, how to do data analytics, how to be an entrepreneur. These are the key skills. We shouldn't be teaching them about English kings or different chemicals. They need skills so everyone's an entrepreneur. That is the most important thing. I made this point, I was on a panel at an HR conference, and I said that, you know, the education system's fundamentally broken in Singapore. The next day I got an email from the Ministry of Education. The minister will meet you next Tuesday at 2:30 p.m. Please come to the ministry. Actually, I didn't even think it said please. I read it and went, oh, I went white. I'm like, oh no. Now, I know my job as a chief innovation officer is to slowly get fired while effecting change. That's my job, yeah? That's the job of every head of innovation. Now, at DBS, I've done really well at the change. I need to ramp up the firing. But I thought this could be a really quick firing. Potential loss of visa. I better take my passport with me, just in case. So I turn up at the ministry. There's like 50 people there. The minister, Minister Wong, isn't there. And they said, oh, thanks for coming. I said, look, I'm really, really sorry about what I said about education. And they said, we're glad you come to talk about Unicorn. What's this? What did you say about education? I said, sorry, another conversation. Unicorn. Let's talk about Unicorn. Because when I was on stage, I also talked about Unicorn. I forgot that bit. I was focusing on the negative. And so we talked about Unicorn. They were very impressed. Next week, the Ministry of Finance will meet you at 2:30 next Tuesday. Next week, IRIS, the tax office, will meet you next Tuesday. Next week, Ministry of Defence will meet you next. I had to go around every single ministry and show them Unicorn. And then I was in Taiwan earlier in the year, and I had lunch. One of my team, Jen, who's I don't know how she's done it, but she's made DBS the most famous bank in Taiwan. She's got me on the primetime news and all sorts. It got me lunch with the Minister of Education. So I had lunch with him, and he said, oh, we've just rolled out this new program to our MBA, not MBA students, to our master's students. He goes, do you know what it's called? I'm like, is it Unicorn? He said, yes, thank you. He said, we've changed it, we've copied it, but we've rolled it out now for our masters to set up their own startups. And so our kind of, my kind of usual trying to raise the ambition of the team, having a clear intent of, you know, we're going to reinvent education in Singapore, I think we did a little bit of that. I think we actually did. We've pushed the dial on that. And that's important as well, not only to have a clear intent, but have an ambitious intent. My phrase is shoot for the stars and you might hit the moon, yeah? Always aim high, because the world will lower it for you. Don't you worry, yeah? You don't lower your ambition, someone else will do it for you. Yeah, if you shoot for the moon, you'll hit the ground. But we did our bit with Unicorn. Oh, I don't know where the videos are in this, wait a minute. So here's a video of Unicorn. Should have notes for this, shouldn't I? There we go. This is the pitch day, I believe, 2017.
Hi everyone, welcome to the 2017 DBS Unicorn Demo Day! Out of the 1,000 applicants, 60 were selected to participate in the 12-hour hackathon called Idea Smash. And out of the 60, 24 emerged as the chosen few for the 2017 Unicorn Cohort.
It is very labor intensive for us as the innovation group, for DBS in general, and also very labor intensive for the interns themselves. But the outcome is really just proof positive that it is worth doing.
I think we had a lot of fun. I think that's very important, right? It's a lot more fun when you have fun at work, right? So I also think that quite a lot of the presentations had clear thinking, right? And I think the simple ideas that is well explained and well executed and well thought through were the ones that really made a difference today.
Well, that's it. That's quite something. So it's fun, and we hope these people, half of them we hire into the bank to cause some trouble. Hopefully the other half will go outside the bank and cause even more trouble in the world of entrepreneurship. When we entered the startup ecosystem, I've been in startups and done various things in the startup space. We didn't call them startups when I was younger. It was just called a business that really wasn't worth that much. And I had a few employees. I had a games business for a while. It's like I was cognizant that we're the big bank. And, you know, to enter a startup community, we need to be credible. And we can be credible through our people, but more importantly, with our intent. So our intent in entering is, we're not here to make money for startups. We're not really here to find new products and services. We're here to drive the entrepreneurial ecosystem in Singapore and play our part and be a responsible member of that community. And so the first thing we set up was called Hotspot Accelerator. We noticed a gap in the market. There was hardly any fintech accelerators at the time, and nearly all fintech accelerators didn't have any Singaporeans in them, and there wasn't any early stage businesses. Because we're not there to make money out of it, we targeted early stage Singaporean co-founded startups. And so we filled that gap, and that was very successful for us. We ran two rounds of that. We gave them $25,000, took no equity, and brought them, you know, mentors and money, essentially, to help accelerate them. A few of them have gone on to do very well. This year, we changed that slightly. We thought, what we need to do now, a lot of startups said, actually, we want to work with you, DBS. There's a lot of accelerators now. Some would say too many accelerators in Singapore. We want to work with DBS. So we looked at the process of how we go from business problem to bolting a startup into the bank. Do you know that took 6 to 9 months? 6 to 9 months. So we analyzed that process, and Rudy created a program called Startup Exchange that he runs. We can now go from business problem to wired into the bank in 4 weeks. Yeah, you looked up, stopped using your phones then, didn't you? 4 weeks, from 6 to 9 months to 4 weeks. So this year we've analyzed over 1,000 startups, 150 have pitched to executives around problems, and we're in the process of wiring up 9. Some have gone live, and then some of them are over there as well. Now we've released the world's biggest API platform, so 155 APIs. We think we can get that down to 2 weeks. So we have a huge funnel now where we can match startups to bank problems. Again, we had the right intent, so we're accelerating that very quickly. The next thing I learned is everyone gets fed. This is Jim Eady here in the middle. He's the head of construction for this. This is the world's strongest man here. So everything you see in the hotel, you've seen in the photos, came on this bike. I know that because I don't have a helicopter. So there's no other way. The road finishes about 15 minutes away from the hotel, and there's a little track that goes up and downhill, and that's the bike. So on that bike came the water tanks, the toilets, the bricks, the wood, the sand, the cement, the roof tiles, everything, every single thing, apart from the generator. That took 12 people and about 2 days. That was pretty heavy. I was tired just watching them do it, in fairness. But they're pretty strong out there. He's the world's strongest man, this guy. He did let me win at an arm wrestle, which I thought was quite nice. Well, this is a new presenter mouse. I do apologize. First time I've used it. He's amazingly strong. If you notice, he's got a bag of sand down here to counteract the weight of the stone tiles that we've got there. Yeah, he's a master at this. So I started the construction, and I thought, excellent, I can get some really cool tools. I thought, I want a cement mixer, get a jackhammer, one of those big saw things. I was like a little kid, thinking of all the exciting construction stuff I can get. But I didn't, the first thing I bought, or was bought for me, was a rice cooker. A rice cooker. I thought it was like a small cement mixer. And I said, why have you bought a rice cooker? I said, oh, boss, because you need to feed them now. I didn't realize that. Now I'd created an intent that people had joined on with and followed me. I actually need to feed them. So the first bill I had was a rice cooker, and then I have to feed all my staff now. I've got about 50 in Indonesia. I have to feed them. That made me think. I never realized that. That wouldn't really happen in other, you know, countries I've lived in, like Australia or the UK. It cost too much in sausages in the UK for starters, but I had to feed them. It made me realize, actually, if somebody does come with your intent, everyone should get fed, shouldn't they? I really dislike when I see corporate emails that go something like this. Hi, I'm an executive. I did this amazing product launch, and aren't I amazing? Who sees them at their company? Yeah? I'm sure more of you do. I prefer an email that goes, we did an amazing product launch. Here are the 10 people who made this happen. Aren't they amazing? Isn't that a much better email? How much extra did it cost? How much extra time? None, it was the same. How inspired are those 10 people now they've been fed? Now they got rewarded and recognized for their work? Just frustrates me when I see emails like this without giving, you know, the due respect to the people who actually did the work and fed them. So when we operate, we think about how do we feed. One of the big programs we did was DBS Vault. We created a crowdsourcing platform, and we rolled out across the bank. Now, many of these are used to collect ideas. I'm sure you've seen them before. People put in ideas, they comment, they vote, and then usually the best idea goes on to either into production or into the ether in many cases. But we didn't really, our prime motivation was actually not to collect ideas. That was more a side effect. What we wanted to do is have one tool that we could touch the entire staff base, that people could put in ideas and they would be recognized. People would vote on them, comment on them, and they'd win iPads. We'd take their name to the executive team and talk about what a great concept they had. And so it's a great way to digitally start a conversation around the business of innovation with everyone. This year, I can't believe we've done this, we have 1/3 of the entire bank globally has engaged on this platform this year. 1/3 of the bank globally. So our staff base now is around 25,000, thanks to our ANZ acquisition, and 8,727 people have engaged on this platform. That is unbelievable. And so we're touching 1/3 of the bank with just this one platform. And we solve some problems. We get some good ideas. A second thing we do is we use this space to connect inside and outside the bank. And so Annie, who runs DAX, awesome innovator, we run internal sessions like events like, well, external sessions like this. We run maker sessions where staff can build drones and VR and robots. And we have stuff like table tennis competitions for our neighbors around here. We have poker nights for venture capital. Thankfully, I was away because I'm not a big fan of children. But I saw some photos where they brought children in. I think it was theirs. Hopefully it was theirs. And there was kids everywhere. I do like kids, but there was kids everywhere. So we're trying to make this like a hub of the community because we feel that's really, really important that people get fed. And that feeding can be something tiny. It could be coming in and talking to some of the great innovators I've got on my team and getting some, you know, guidance on your startup. It could be that someone actually really wants to do something in VR. This is their first step towards that. It could be when we pay bank staff to set up their own startups. That's the start of their career in creating a unicorn. It could be just a way, really, so people could meet other people and then come together and then do something amazing. You know, all of this takes effort. It takes time. But there's nothing behind it going, this is how we make money. This is how we're going to do this. It's about how do we bring these people together? How do we make sure everyone gets fed? And that's really, really important to every single person in my team. They agonize over stuff like this. The details they agonized over to make sure you had a great time today at this space is unbelievable. The messages I see go backs and forwards to make it special. The second thing I'm going to talk about is around driving behavior through models. This is Mawen. Mawen is one of my construction team. I flew in from Singapore and my driver, Mr. Mahmood, picked me up. This is a few years ago now. And he said, oh, boss, Mawen's had an accident. Bad. So I said, oh, what happened? He goes, oh, almost cut his arm off with a saw. I'm like, oh, this is terrible. Take me to the hospital. He said, oh, no, look, hotel this way, hospital this way. It'll take too long. I said, no, take me to the hospital. I'll go see him. And I turned up at the hospital, and Marwan's there, and he's white. I've never seen anyone so ill and still alive. He was bright white. I was like, oh, my God, lost a lot of blood, had his arm all done up, lying in bed. His mum's there crying. His sister's there crying. His father had died, so Mawen was the only breadwinner in the family. So not only is Mawen badly injured and could possibly die, they're bankrupt. They've got the hospital bills, and there's no money coming in now. That's it. He's the only breadwinner in the family. And I walked in, and his mother looked at me, and she stopped crying, and she had hope in her eyes. Because the big boss was here, and the big boss was going to make it okay. And Mr. Mahmood said to me, he said, look, the hospital bills are really big. This has been an emergency thing. This was actually before the government gave universal healthcare in Indonesia. And he said, "You're going to pay the bill?" I said, I looked at his mother and I was like, I said, "No. No, I'm not going to." Even though the bill was minor, really, in the scheme of things, especially for me, it's like a few flights in and out of India. I said, "No, I'm not going to. What I will do, I'll pay half the bill. Pay half the bill. You can tell her now, I'll cover half the bill. Just don't tell the doctor I pay half the bill, otherwise the bill will double. If they think it's a foreigner paying." And then I went back, got to the jungle really late, got back to about 2 a.m., woke up Saturday, got the Jamini I showed earlier, the head of construction, got him in, said, "Jamini, what happened to Maren?" He goes, "Oh, big electric saw." Cross his arm, like, okay. I said, "I need you to pay half the medical bill for Maren." And he said, "Oh, no, boss, we don't do that here. It's not what we..." I said, "Okay, but I need you to pay it." He said, "No." I said, "Okay, you're fired. Get off the construction site." He said, "What?" I said, "You're fired, get off." He said, "Oh, you want me to pay?" I said, "Yeah, you've got to pay." Okay, like this. Walks out. Now, why did I do that? Two reasons. One is, I've never had an accident since. Now Jamidi knows you have to pay half the medical bill for any accident. He makes sure that young kids don't go on the site without proper training for circular saws or any other accident at all. Secondly, I have a lot of construction people that kind of go up and down. I don't know everyone on the construction site. I can imagine there's another construction site, somebody gets injured, suddenly they're one of my employees, because big boss pays all medical. So one was to drive a model around no accidents. The other one was to defend me from fraud, because obviously if someone's had a bad accident, they need someone to pay. And then magically, they'll be one of my employees. So really thinking about what models you set, what KPIs you set. KPIs are just really dumb, I'm sorry. They're not well thought out. They don't think about, for me, KPIs are around how you change behavior. Not about how you perform success or measure success. They're behavior change instrument. Corporate governance has basically turned into a method to say no. And KPIs are just a way to measure success rather than really what they should be for. Maren, actually, thankfully, he's got a scar literally this thick across there. His arm was like this. And so I said to Jamini, I said, "I'll personally pay my money for Maren to keep working. And what I'll do, I'll teach him how to paint. Because they're terrible painters out there, bless them. They get it everywhere and the lines aren't straight." And so because Maren's arm was fixed in a cast, he could put a paint can over it. And then he had one hand free, he could paint. So I went and bought him two sets of paintbrushes, and I spent a couple of days teaching him how to paint like a pro, how to cut in around windows, how to use like magical things like dust sheets, which means paint doesn't just go everywhere. So their normal model is find the biggest brush. Two, make sure it's like mostly broken. Three, dip it in the paint. Four, just go like this everywhere. And five, then clean up all the paint spots that are absolutely everywhere. So I was teaching him the right methods, how to look after his brushes. I bought him expensive ones. I told him they were expensive. He had to look after them. And so he was working immediately. And I paid his salary. I didn't tell him that. Hopefully he's not here, is he? And that kept him work. Over time, his arm isn't as back as good as it is, but it's actually pretty good. He can bend it, he can pick stuff up and that kind of stuff now. And funnily enough, he's got lots of jobs from expats who want paint jobs in the area, because he's the only one who knows how to paint with a certain level of quality. At the bank, we've set up a 4D innovation model to drive behavior change, to get people to do innovation in a structured and well thought out manner. It's called the 4D model. So the first most important step in innovation is discover, understand the problem, spend time really working out. Have you got the problem? Have you got a symptom? Who's got the problem? Does the problem have enough pain? We all want to create solutions. This is one of the biggest problems I see in innovation. Everyone wants to create something. So they look at the problem and go, yeah, there's the problem, run forward and start inventing stuff. Suddenly realizing when they launch that actually that really wasn't a great problem. And so the thing doesn't succeed. So first is discover. Second is define. This is where you start coming up with kind of idea fragments, start coming up with concepts. Develop is where you start turning them into prototypes and experimenting with clients, and this is iterative. And fourth is deliver. So whether that's a new bank branch, get your cement and a construction crew, or whether it's an app, then get some technical resources. But these are all iterative, so you're continually experimenting as you go through these cycles as well. But this model changes behavior. It's a structured model to make anyone an innovator, and I mean anyone. Actually, maybe not everyone, but 99% of people can be an innovator through this model. What we do then, we take our 4D model and we make it more fun. So we use it in things like hackathons. So this year alone, I think Mark, who's at the back there, you can't miss him, he's got a really big beard. His team, you know, work on delivering all this 4D model. And we've done over 100 hackathons this year, 100. So we use them for hiring. We use them to come up with new ideas. We pair bankers up with students, startups, corporate partners, government agencies, customers. It's compulsory in DBS now. If you want to be a future leader, you have to invent your own startup. It's compulsory through HR. It's a yearly program. You get put on a program called the Talent Program. And as part of the training in that, the compulsory course is doing a hackathon to invent your own startup. That's it. So all our future leaders at DBS have invented their own startup company. We partner with HR, they run it, we support, and that's through a hackathon process as well. And so it's one thing having the kind of education, but you've really got to make it interesting. So once you've set your model, then how do you make the behavior change happen where people really want to be part of that change? It can't just be, you know, forced change. It's better that it's a pull model, that people want to come to you and be part of this. This is a hackathon in progress. This is one of our very earliest ones, but one of our biggest.
I want the people to wake up to the new way that mankind lives, to what digital means. And you can't do that in classrooms. You can't put people in front of a blackboard and teach them what digital is all about. The only way you can do it is through experiential learning. Now this megathon hackathon is so exciting because it allows us to check many things in one go. It's a tremendous opportunity for us to get our best and brightest and give them a tremendously different exposure to the new digital world that is on us, which allows you to get startups, people who think differently, mix and match them with our people, and give them an opportunity to think in a different frame. It's just fantastic.
They were created to give people a sense of what it was like to work in an intense, rapid innovation environment, to come up with solutions in a very short period of time that would spark inspiration within the business to do something around those solutions.
We have 85 of our most senior people from all over the world involved in this and 20 startup teams. So it's about 150 people involved in this production, this event that's going on.
They're trying to do immersion into some customers' problems, build something and act and get something delivered within these 3 days. This is giving them a microcosm of the way they should be operating.
Because through the experiments that we run, there is no way they don't fail. They have to fail in order to succeed. So I think people are now less afraid of failure.
I would say the biggest thing is creative thinking and trying to incorporate elements of human-centered design. I think it's one thing to just kind of talk about it, but really kind of bringing in those principles and saying this is how you apply them to solve a problem. And I think it's stuff that they can take back and say, okay, we're not just going to solve in a traditional corporate sense. Let's really understand who is the end user of this product or solution and how do we serve their need.
Critical point that I learned is to be thinking out of the box. Don't think about the boundaries first. There are a lot of possibilities. This will help me do my job better. It's going to change my work style, to change my attitude to my customers.
And that actually the tools are actually quite simple and straightforward for them to be able to use and take back to the workplace. So the hackathon has many different outputs. Clearly the idea is something that's of real value, but really the culture change is what's most important.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6.
So by the end of today, we'll have done 50 teams, 50 solutions, built 50 apps across the 4 different hackathons.
That's why we're running the hackathons. That's why we're having our mission of create joyful banking. It's to create the leadership environment where the whole organization is filled with leaders who have a common vision and purpose.
The winning team is Monopoly!
But perhaps in some ways the most important, to me, this notion of trying to change the culture of the company, of trying to create the confidence in ourselves to take some risks, to experiment a bit, to try a few things which are different, to have fun while you're doing it. That's the kind of company we're trying to build. And the Megathon is a fantastic tool to be able to bring that culture to life.
That's quite an old video now, but still very powerful. I think Mark was telling me that this year we've had 4,000 staff grow through the 4D model. So the scale of the stuff we do at the bank is significant. And that's what it's all about. You can't just tell people to innovate. You can't even give them the tools to innovate. It's about experiential learning. They've got to do it. Yeah, the world wasn't changed by talking. It's by doing. That's the most important thing. My final lesson is about a safe place to innovate. This is Harry. He loves his hot hats, even though it's 32 degrees up in the jungle some days. Harry's job, he had a great job. For a few dollars a day, he had to carry the bags of cement off that motorbike and then up the hill for the construction guys to build. So when I said great job, it was a bit sarcastic. Not a great, but he was happy. Yeah, well, you know, they just want work, so they're fine with that. But I noticed in the evenings when the cement was drying, there was some left over. He'd carve kind of shapes in it and play with it, and it looked quite artistic. So I said to him, I said, Harry, why don't you do some cement carvings in our restaurant here? This is the restaurant. He said, oh, no, boss, cannot, no good. I said, oh, no, Harry, I think you'd be fine. Why didn't you do that? No, cannot. I go, right, Harry, here's what we're going to do. He says, you know, you're not going to carry bags of cement anymore. He went, oh, boss, I get fired? I'm like, no, you're not getting fired, Harry. What I want you to do is I'll give you this rectangle in the restaurant. Every day, put cement on, carve it, photograph it, send it to me over Facebook, they've all got Facebook, and then break it. And do that all week, and on Friday, leave it there, because I'll be out Friday, I want to see what you've done. And he goes, okay. He did that, it's brilliant. Well, it was this. So he's ended up doing all the carvings for the restaurant, and actually he's in with another guy doing we set him up in a business doing carving. So he's gone on to be successful. We took that impact a failure away from him. So he could try, he could do something new, he could fail, it was fine. It was contained, he was getting paid to fail. We do that at the bank. We ran over 1,000 experiments a year. The best thing I like that we've done is I've been in meetings where someone will come up with some fairly ambitious idea and another executive will say, no, we can't do that. That's a stupid idea. Now I've noticed they say, hey, why don't we experiment? And so it's a get out of jail free card for anything ambitious. You can go for something big and bold and say it's an experiment. So as long as you manage the risk, put it in a box, and it doesn't cost a huge amount of money, you can run experiments. Sometimes they've took that the other way, where one of their projects is failing, and they go, oh yeah, oh, I forgot to say, that was an experiment. I'd like, well, you can't really say that after the fact, but I like what you're doing. So over 1,000 experiments a day. Space is really important for this. We find when you're making a change, you need the physical evidence of a change. The counter to that is many companies build a sexy space, like an innovation center or, you know, a new office. Obviously, they just copy Google. And then they go, right, we're innovative now. Everything's changed. Of course it hasn't changed. You've just changed the space. They'll work exactly as they've always done, just in a nicer looking space. So you've got to balance the two. But a space enables people to collaborate closer together. A space like this, people know it's different. They come in, wow, this isn't the bank. We can do something different here. We can be more ambitious, even if that is unconscious. So we've been on a big space journey at DBS. We've got multiple more innovative spaces. You might recognize this place. It's a lot tidier there than it is now. I'll just point that out. So what's the next steps in the journey? This is the river, one of the rivers in Bukit Lawang. So this is my construction team, my new construction team, and we've just finished. I took 3 months off work to finish. I bought part of an island up in the north of Sumatra in Bandar Aceh, where they had the tsunami. And there's quite a lot of damage to the reef, and the locals were spearfishing it and dynamiting this beautiful reef. So I did a deal with the locals. I said to the head of the village, I say, hey, I'm thinking of building a hotel here. And the head of the village said, good. I said, look, it's going to bring lots of tourists are going to come. And I said, they're going to bring lots of money. He said, good. I said, and I'll hire some people from the village. I need drivers. I need some construction. I need people to do gardening. He said, thank you. I said, but there's a big problem. He said, oh, no problem. I said, no, it's a big problem. You're killing the fish. No fish, no tourists, no money, no job. And so the next day, they made their own signs and stopped everyone spearfishing and dynamiting the reef. And I started the build about 2 years ago. It took 2 years. I took 3 months off for the final finishing. So I wanted to stand over them and make sure the quality was high and to launch the business, get the operation set up. And I built a beautiful hotel, really high quality hotel called Pullaway Paradise. It's got its own cove. We've got dolphins leap out the water, turtles. Every fish imaginable is up there. It's absolutely incredible. You can go out, swim out, and pick up a lobster and give it to the chef. That's quite something. A bit different from Singapore. But it made me think, you know, the world is moving towards ecosystems. I think some of the biggest companies, most valuable companies of the world, don't own anything. We hear the stories about, you know, Airbnb doesn't own any rooms. Well, I think they're building some now. Uber doesn't own any cars, nor a license to operate in London. And so they're big platform companies, they're ecosystems. They say actually in the future that you'll have two jobs in a company, actually three. So you'll have the chief innovation officer, who's lucky, I still got a job, and their job is to come up with IP. Then the IP goes somewhere for manufacturing, then someone else distributes it, and then someone else sells it, and et cetera. So you can run a whole company. And then the second job's the CEO. So if something goes wrong, it's their job to go to prison. And the third job is the person who feeds the security guard dog who looks after the data center. And that's the three jobs. Now, it may not end up like that, but essentially companies will be a collection of different ecosystems plugged together very, very rapidly. The finance industry is moving towards ecosystems. So we thought, okay, we don't mess around at DBS. So we launched the world's largest banking API platform, over 155 APIs. More importantly, we launched with an entire ecosystem business ready to go. So we've got over 50 partnerships on launch day, all the way from McDonald's to small companies, small startups like SoCash to social enterprises like Homage. This is our future. All businesses are going to be, to a smaller or greater degree, connected to and operating through ecosystems. And I think we're at the end. So the orangutans thank you, I thank you, and my team thank you for coming.